Time for convening haven't arrived. The Senate will come to order. Welcome to the 38th legislative day. Chair recognizes that distinguished and debonair senator from the 53rd.
Excuse me. Let me pull my...
Pull you. There you go. There you go.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's a gloomy day outside, but it's a glorious day inside the state Senate. The men and women here are ready to do the people's work. A moment in history, back in 1974, the senator from the 56 burned his sister's dollhouse, and from there on, he's been in the fire service ever since. The journal's been read and found to be correct.
Glad he knows how to use a water hose. Is there objection to dispensing with the reading of the journal? A reading of the journal is dispensed with. Is there objection? Confirmation of the journal. Chair hears none, and the journal is confirmed. All senators having bills and resolutions to introduce, please bring them to the secretary's desk at this time. First reading and reference of Senate bills and resolutions.
Senate Resolution 484 by Senator Hardison of the 15th, a resolution creating Senate
Rules Committee.
Senate Resolution 489 by Senators Lee and the 30th.
Rules Committee.
Senate Resolution 496 by Senator Jackson II and others, a resolution creating Senate Urban Development.
Urban Affairs.
Senate Resolution 502 by Senators Gooch of the 51st and others, a resolution encouraging the Congress of the United
Rules
States.
Rules Committee.
Senate Resolution 503 by Senator Jackson II and others, a resolution creating the Senate
Rules
African.
Rules Committee.
Senate Resolution 504 by Senator Williams of the 27th, Brass the 28th.
Rules Committee.
Senate Resolution 506 by Senator Dugan the 30th, a resolution creating
Rules Committee.
Mr. President, that concludes the order.
First reading in reference of House bills.
House Bill 590 by Representative Quick of the 117th and others, a bill to be designed to enact an amendment act creating
state
the
and local governmental operations.
House Bill 591 by Representative Jackson of the 128th, a bill to be designed to enact
state
amendment
state and local governmental operations.
House Bill 594 by Representative Strachan of the 104th and others, a bill to be designed to enact
state and local governmental operations.
House Bill 595 by Representative Taylor of the 79th and others, a bill to be
state and local governmental operations.
House Bill 596 by Representative Henson of the 86th and others, a bill to be designed to enact
state and local governmental operations.
House Bill 601 by Representative Turner of the 21st.
State and local governmental operations.
Mr. President, that concludes the order.
Secretary Reed reports the standing committees.
Mr. President, the Senate Rules Committee has had under consideration the following legislation instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with final recommendation. Senate Resolution 481 do pass, and House Bill 413 pursuant to Senate Rule 2-1.10B referred by the Senate Rules Committee to the Senate Committee on Regulated Industries and Utilities from the General Calendar, submitted by Senator Mullis of the 53rd. Mr. President, the Senate Committee on Reapportionment and Redistricting has had under consideration the following legislation instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. House Bill 515 do pass by substitutes, submitted by Senator Watson of the 1st. Mr. President, the Senate Committee on Finance has had under consideration the following legislation instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. House Bill 155 do pass by substitute. House Bill 225 do pass by substitute. House Bill 285 do pass. House Bill 329 do pass by substitute. And House Bill 342 do pass, submitted by Senator Huffstetler of the 52nd. Mr. President, the Senate Committee on State and Local Government Operations has had under consideration the following legislation instructed to report the same back to the Senate with following recommendation. Senate Bill 267 do pass. House Bill 439 do pass. House Bill 575 do pass. And my Senator Albers of the 56th. Mr. President, the Senate Committee on Higher Education has had under consideration the following legislation instructed to report the same back to the Senate with following recommendation. House Bill 432 do pass. House Bill 448 do pass. And my Senator Miller of the 40th. Mr. President, Senate Committee on Agriculture and Consumer Affairs has had under consideration the following legislation instructed to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. House Bill 40 do pass. Submitted by Senator Wilkinson of the 50th. Mr. President, Senate Committee on Education and Youth has had under consideration the following legislation instructed to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. House Bill 273 do pass by substitute. House Bill 430 do pass by substitute. Submitted by Senator Tippins of the 37th. Mr. President, Senate Committee on Natural Resources and the Environment has had under consideration the following legislation instructed to report the same back to the Senate following recommendation. House Bill 275 do pass, and my Senator again of the 47th. Mr. President, Senate Committee on Judiciary has had under consideration the following legislation instructed to report the same back to the Senate following recommendation. House Bill 5 do pass by substitute. House Bill 9 do pass by substitute. House Bill 137 do pass by substitute. House Bill 197 do pass. House Bill 203 do pass. House Bill 293 do pass. House Bill 308 do pass. House Bill 344 do pass. And my Senator Stone of the 23rd. And Mr. President, Senate Committee on Regulated Industries and Utilities has had under consideration the following legislation instructing to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. House Bill 413 do pass by substitute. Submitted by Senator Jeffries of the 17th. That concludes the order.
Thank you.
Secretary will read bills and resolutions for the second time.
Senate Resolution 481 by Senator Stone, 23rd and others. Senate Study Committee on Senate Bill 86, create. House Bill 5 by President Caldwell, 131st and others. Courts, compensation of juvenile court judges, change provisions. House Bill 9 by President Blackman of the 146th and others. Crimes and offenses, use of device to film under or through person's clothing under certain circumstances, prohibit. House Bill 40 by President Turner, the 21st and others. Evidence, confidentiality of certain medical information of animals within a veterinarian's care, provide exception. House Bill 137 by President Turner, the 21st and others. Crimes and offenses, restrictions on contingency fee compensation of an attorney appointed in forfeiture actions, change provisions. House Bill 155 by President Carter, the 175th and others. Georgia Musical Investment Act, an act. House Bill 197 by President Teasley of the 37th and others. Fair Business Practices Act, requirements for solicitations of services for obtaining a copy of an instrument conveying real estate, provide. House Bill 203 by President Strickland of the 111th and others. Breach of restrictive covenants, provide accrual periods of rights of action, provisions. House Bill 225, President Powell, 171st and others. Rideshare networks, now licensing and sales tax exemption, repeal inoperable provisions. House Bill 273, President Douglas of the 78th and others. Quality Basic Education Act, daily recess for students in kindergarten in grades 1 through 5, provide. House Bill 275, President Dubnik of the 29th and others. Game and fish, rules and regulations used to establish criminal violations, chain provisions. House Bill 285, President Knight of the 130th. Ad valorem tax, criteria used by tax assessors to determine fair market value of real property, revised. House Bill 293 by President Silcox of the 52nd and others. Evidence procedure relating to child testimony of sexual contact or physical abuse, provide effective date. House Bill 308 by President Beskin of the 54th and others. Domestic relations, child support, and act provisions recommended by Georgia Child Support Commission. House Bill 329 by President Powell of the 171st and others. Income tax, rate of tax imposed on the taxable net income of individuals, modify. House Bill 344 by President Dempsey of the 13th and others. Paternity, parties beyond movements and a child support case, request a genetic test, allow. House Bill 430 by President Brockway of the 102nd and others. Governor's Education Reform Commission, charter schools, implement recommendations. House Bill 432 by Representative Dumnick of the 29th and others. Tuition grants, certain institutions that lack accreditation be approved for tuition equalization purposes, provide. House Bill 448 by President Williams of the 119th and others. Non-public post-secondary education commission requires certain post-secondary institutions to qualify for exemptions provisions. House Bill 515 by President Caldwell of the 131st and others. State House districts revise boundaries of a certain district. That concludes the order.
It is time for the morning roll call. Time for the morning roll call. Are there any motions to excuse? Any motions to excuse? Any motions? Senators, please signify your presence by voting yay switch. Secretary will unlock the machine. It is now time for our morning devotion. Time for our morning devotion. Would ask that all senators please take your seats and cease all audible conversation at this time. What am I looking at?
Oh.
Only one that I see on the far right is the something to do with a dog and a bounty and a hunter. I'm not sure. We've got the roll call. Everyone was recorded, just a malfunction in the board. Now time for our morning devotion. Morning devotion, it is now my distinct honor to call upon the Senator from the 35th for the purpose of leading us in our pledge and introducing our chaplain of the day. Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to our American flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And now to our Georgia flag. I pledge allegiance to the Georgia flag
and to the principles for which it stands, wisdom, justice, and moderation.
Good morning, Senators. I am very pleased and honored to present our pastor of the day. He has been celebrating 40 years of service to God and the community. The Mount Ephraim Baptist Church of Atlanta, Georgia was organized on June 16th of 1970. In an apartment where Pastor R.L. White lived. There were only 15 people present and 12 joined. And they took in a collection of $15. And for this group, they had no idea what God would have them to go through in a wonderful ministry. But the pastor, Dr. R.L. White, was a young man at the age of 26, but had determined to lead the church the way that God wanted him to do. In the 40 years following the organizational date, God has blessed this ministry to achieve distinction in so many areas. In 68, he was called the fastest growing church in North America. A national television ministry on the Word Network was reached 34 million homes in the United States and 125 foreign countries. A ministry in Ghana, West Africa, where Mount Ephraim has built a church, an elementary school, and is currently building a hospital. Mount Ephraim also has a local TV ministry that feeds to several stations right here in Georgia that reaches another 900,000 viewers. Several albums and CDs, of which three have gone to the National Billboard magazine, were written and sung by our pastor. A homeless ministry he has that feeds 50 to 100 homeless men daily. Many health concerns support groups have grown out of Mount Ephraim, and a multi-million dollar budget is their annual amount. Dr. White has gone back to school and achieved 4 degrees and associate degrees from Atlanta Metropolitan College, a bachelor's of ministry degree from Luther Rice Seminary, a Master of Divinity degree from the Morehouse School of Religion of the Interdenominational Theological Center in Atlanta, a Doctorate of Ministry degree from the same university, and presently, Dr. White holds key positions in so many different areas, including president of the Atlanta branch of the NAACP, National Alumni President of ITC, and the list goes on and on and on. And to celebrate the 40th anniversary at Mount Ephraim this year, a 200 voice choir from the church came together and recently recorded what is destined to become the top selling CD in the country. Dr. White is married to Reverend Lorraine Jock White, and many of us know her because for years she's been the commentator on WAOK Talk Radio, and most of us have been interviewed by her. And she is awesome, anointed, appointed, accepted, and approved by God. And he is truly blessed. So this morning, Dr. Ariel White, the blessed man of God, will come before us and give us a prayer and inspiration. Dr. White, it's my honor to present you to our Senate this morning.
To the Lieutenant Governor Casey Cagle, to the Senate Secretary David Cook, to my sponsor for today, Senator Donzella James, who we love and are praying for her in her illness. I have to mention Senator Lucas, who is from my hometown of Macon, Georgia, and also the other senators. Many of you already know, and we have known each other for years, and it's so good to see you. If I start calling names, I will make a mistake and leave somebody out. So I'm just saying to all of you, it's my pleasure being with you today. Many years ago, when I entered into ministry, I was living in Washington, D.C. I was advised to go to the Washington Baptist Seminary so that I could become qualified in the word, and that was a problem. I had a job with the United Postal Service, APLUM, OMMS, Official Mail Messenger Service. We went to all of the governor's buildings, we went to executive office buildings, the White House. But the school did not have day classes, and I did not want to leave that plum of a job that I had, because it would mean that I would have to take a walking route as a postman almost all the way out in suburbia. So I had a choice. Would I give up my job that I loved so much, or would I keep the job and put going to school off? I prayed. I prayed to God that the seminary would change its mind and start having classes on the time that would not take me from my job. It became obvious. They were years away from even thinking about that. So the question was, am I willing to give up what means so much to me for school? So I prayed to the Lord, if you don't change the situation, change me. And the Lord did it. When the new term came in, my whole perspective had changed. And I took that route. I remember walking up steps with ice and snow, and I'm saying, wow, I don't know if I like this or not. But what I did not know was that I was making an investment in the future, an investment in a ministry that would carry me many years, even until today. And the scripture that has meant so much to me is found in the Old Testament scripture, the book of Micah, chapter 6, verse 8. He hath showed thee, O man, what is good. And what doth the Lord require of thee but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. This has been one of my guiding principles. And I would like to offer that to you today as you deliberate on issues that affect thousands and even millions of people. I suggest that if you can just take the scripture as you struggle through to the decisions that you have to make. And the question is, the litmus test, I call it, that does my decision reflect on my being just, or that I'm loving mercy? And does it show that I am walking humbly with my God? These are the questions, I think, that would help anyone in the position of shaping the laws of the state of Georgia. So as today, ask you to put that somewhere in your extra reading time and to see if you now have favor with God because you love mercy, you're just, and you walk humbly with your God. Shall we pray? Oh God, as we struggle to represent those of our constituents for the common good of all who have entrusted us with so much, help us to be a manifestation of your love as we bring into fruition laws that reflect your wisdom and your understanding, that the world may know that you indeed have been our supreme guide as we walk among others who depend on us. We ask these blessings now, and it is in the name of our Almighty God we pray. Amen.
Yeah.
It is an honor to present the Doctor of the Day, and to do so, I call upon the distinguished senator from the 18th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, colleagues. I'm very pleased to present to you our Doctor of the Day, Jason Smith, MD. He's a board-certified pediatrician who cares for his patients at Primary Pediatrics in Macon. Dr. Smith earned his medical degree from Mercer University School of Medicine and completed his residency at the Medical Center of Central Georgia. Dr. Smith and his wife, Tammy, have three boys, J7, Cope is four, and Kale is one. And during his spare time, he enjoys hunting, fishing, and playing golf. He's got good Middle Georgia roots. He's from Macon, and we're real pleased to have him here as our doctor of the day. Doctor, please speak to us.
I appreciate y'all having me today. I drove up from Macon this morning through the traffic. It was fun. But thank y'all for having me. Y'all know where we are if you need anything today, and I appreciate it again. Thanks.
We need, just so everybody knows, we need to do a test. No? Let's do a test. We're going to do a test on the board. Secretary will unlock the machine. Y'all push your buttons, make sure they're working. It's a test, so this really doesn't matter, except the senator from the 31st always, his green button does not work. Push the green button, senator from the 31st, see if it works. On the passage of the test, the yeas are 27 and the nays are 25, and the test has constitutionally failed but passed under the circumstances. Thank you all for participating in our test. Are there any unanimous consents? We have the governor's appointments, consideration of confirmation of the governor's appointments today that are before you. They have gone through the rules calendar, and the names of the appointees were referred to the Committee on Assignments and placed on your desk February the 17th. So they have been there for some time. The Committee on Assignments recommended the appointments be confirmed as submitted on March the 20th. The list of appointments of names are on your desk this morning. Chair recognizes Senator from the 29th to speak to the appointment.
Thank you, Mr. President. I know that when we had the appointments to the Judicial Qualifications Commission confirmation vote, I requested division of the question. And obviously doing that today to demand a roll call vote on every one of these appointees, we would not do much else other than vote on appointees. So I'm not going to do that, but I did want to just put a couple of observations on the record. First of all, I think it's great that these appointments were submitted to us in compliance with our rules. I think that's the first time in 7 years that's happened, so I think that's a wonderful thing. I do have concern, as I always have had, about the confirmation process. I just fundamentally believe these conferees should go to subject matter committees, that there should be hearings, and that we should have some assurance through our committee process that the names have been vetted. I'm sure these are all wonderful people who will do good work for the state of Georgia and will continue to do good work for the state of Georgia. I am going to vote no because of those process concerns. And the reason I wanted to put that on the record is that even though there don't seem to be the resources to go through this vetting process, I do know that there were enough taxpayer resources to notify appointees in my district last year that I voted no. And the letters that went out to tell them that did not explain this process, did not explain that there's only one vote on hundreds of names, or the lack of vetting within the confirmation process. So for that reason, I'll be voting no today. I appreciate the opportunity to share those thoughts with you. Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the well.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 46th, the Majority Leader.
Thank you, Mr. President. I ask unanimous consent that the reading of the names of the governor's appointments to the various boards, commissions, and authorities be dispensed with, since they've already been printed and placed on the desk for over a month now.
Is there objection? Without objection, we will dispense with the reading. Chair recognizes Senator from the 46th again.
Mr. President, I would also ask unanimous consent that one roll call suffice to confirm all appointments, unless any senator designates any appointee to be removed from the list and voted on individually.
Is there objection? Without objection, we will vote on it with one roll call.
All right.
Chair recognizes Majority Leader again.
Thank you, Mr. President. Then I move that the governor's appointments to the various boards, commissions, and authorities be confirmed as submitted.
Is there objection? Well, yeah. Okay. Chair recognized Senator from the 39th.
Yes, sir. What is our posture that we're in, the process we will be going on?
The posture by which we're in is obviously the senator has moved on these three particular motions. The last motion was to move that the governor's appointment to the various boards and commission of authority be confirmed as submitted. It will require a vote, and this is obviously debatable if one so choose. But that his motion is not a motion of final passage. It requires a vote.
For the point of order, Mr. President.
State
so there will be, this is a debatable issue, and there will be an opportunity to debate.
Well, that debate would be now.
Yeah.
If you're wishing to be recognized for the debate.
Yes, sir. I withdraw my objection in that case.
Thank you. Okay. Chair recognized Senator from the 39th, speak to the governor's appointees.
Mr. President, members of the Senate, I rise to make comment on the issue of the governor's appointments. I have in the past and will continue to do so is make comment on the governor's appointments to various positions when those appointments do not reflect Georgia. One criteria that ought to be used in making appointments is that they reflect Georgia, that they look like the Georgia of 2020 17 and not the Georgia of days gone by. While African Americans make up 30% of the population of this state, these appointments are only 11.5% African American. It's overwhelmingly white, 83%, white, 3% Hispanic, 1.5% Asian, and then other. These appointments are 66% male and 39% 66% male and 34% female. I say that when I say that these appointments that we make this morning do not reflect the Georgia of a modern day, I think these statistics, these numbers bear it out. And that is why I will not be voting for these appointments this hour. We could do better in Georgia. In 2017, there are ways to do better. And I think a no vote will send that message. Thank you, Mr. President. Unless there are questions, which I'd be glad to take, I will retire from the well.
There are no questions, Senator.
Thank you, sir.
Does any other senator wish to speak to the confirmations? Chair recognizes Senator from the second.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise today, ladies and gentlemen, to speak on the governor's appointments. First of all, I want to tell you that I applaud the governor's actions of his appointments when it comes to women across our state. You see that it's 66% men, but it's also 33% women. That's a step in the right direction. That's a step in the right direction. But what I don't see is geographic diversity. You know, and when we talk about this big state, we should also be talking about being geographically diverse. People coming from and representing the state from all across the state. But there's also another measure. There's also something about being racial diversity. You know, this state is 30% African American, about 12% Hispanic. When we look at appointments, we need to be diverse in all steps of the matter. Geographic diversity, racial diversity, diversity with women. But more importantly, we're talking about inclusion. We need to work with the governor's office to be about the action of inclusion, including all people of different ethnic groups from different regions to move this state forward. We cannot be the, Mr. President, we cannot be the governor's appointments of just a greater Atlanta area. We need to reach beyond Atlanta, go as far as Albany, go as far as the coast, go as high as the mountains, to make sure that we can move forward all on one accord, all one people, with the right cause of moving Georgia forward. So I applaud the governor on making the right moves toward women, but we also need to go much further and be racial diverse and geographic diverse also. Mr. President, if there are no questions, I yield well.
Does any other member wish to speak on the matter that's before us? Question is on the confirmation of the governor's appointments. All of those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. Thank you. on the governor's appointments, the confirmations. Confirmation will be 46, and the nays are 3, and the governor's appointments have been confirmed by the Georgia State Senate. Now we're moving to points of personal privilege. Chair recognized Senator on the 14th.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate. What a privilege it is today for me to be able to honor two individuals that are near and dear to myself. Today I'd like to read a resolution to my dear friend, Dr. Austin Flint, and his lovely wife, Bee. It reads, whereas Dr. Austin Flint and Bee Flint have been vital members of Waleska community for the past 48 years, during which time they have demonstrated generosity and friendship to all those around them. And whereas B. Flint served as an English professor for 12 years to the students of Reinhardt University, investing her time and energy toward improving the lives and opportunities to the next generation, and Dr. Flint has served Northwest Georgia community by practicing radiology for nearly 50 years. And whereas Dr. Flint was recently selected to be a member of Reinhardt University's Board of Trustees, and whereas Austin and B. Flint have recently given a gracious and generous $1 million contribution to Reinhardt University to construct a theater and expand their music programs. Whereas Dr. Flint was a founding physician of Radiology Associates of North Georgia and a founding member of St. Clement's Episcopal Church in Canton. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to just take the opportunity to share a little bit about our dear friend standing over here. There are many times we hear from constituents and people in our districts, and the times we hear about it is when they want to complain. But I can say these two individuals not only work within our district and through North Georgia to improve it, but they make sure they let us that are serving know how much they are thrilled when we do the right thing. They let us know how they are praying for us. When we need something, they're there. And today, I just would like to recognize what their contribution giving back to Reinhardt University and to the state of Georgia, how much we appreciate that. So will you join me in just congratulating them on what they've done for our state?
Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the well.
Wonderful family. Thank you very, very much for all your contribution. Chair now recognizes Senator from the 50th.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate. Today it's my pleasure to recognize Dr. Michael Doyle for his work in the area of food safety. As chairman of the Agriculture and Consumer Affairs Committee, I would remind you that as Americans, we have the most abundant, lowest price, safest food in the world. Many times we take that for granted, but we do have someone here with us this morning who's played a large role in the food safety aspect. Dr. Doyle is the University of Georgia Regents Professor of Food Microbiology. He holds 6 U.S. patents in work related to food safety, and he has worked for decades in this area of food safety. We all know how important it is that our food is safe and how unpleasant it is when we have a bad experience. So join me in thanking Dr. Doyle for his work in the area of food safety. Thank you, Mr. President.
Chair now recognizes Senator from the 29th on a point of personal privilege.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise today to talk about the much ballyhooed economic boycott of the state of North Carolina for passing a piece of legislation that takes the controversial position that one should be limited to the bathroom that matches one's sex on one's birth certificate. There's a story in the Washington Times that was published this week. The headline is "Tourism Thriving, Economy Expanding in North Carolina Despite Bathroom Bill Desertions." Economic indicators released for 2016 show that the boycott has failed to derail North Carolina as a regional and national powerhouse, despite the loss of high-profile performances and sporting events. Tourism has thrived. Hotel occupancy, room rates, and demand for rooms and records in 2016, according to the year-end hotel lodging report issued last week by Visit North Carolina. Meanwhile, North Carolina ranked fourth in the nation for attracting and expanding businesses with the arrival of 289 major projects. North Carolina finished first for drawing corporate facilities in the 8-state South Atlantic region. And in November, both Forbes and Site Selection magazine, I know that's a periodical we're all interested in here, ranked North Carolina the number 2 state for business climate. Also unscathed with its seasonally adjusted unemployment rate, which registered at 5.3% in January of 2017. North Carolina Lieutenant Governor Dan Forrest told Texas lawmakers this month the economic effect of the boycott in his state was less than 0.1% of the state's annual domestic gross product. And I would just close by saying this, that the events that left North Carolina actually suffered themselves. The NBA moved its All-Star game and had some of the lowest ticket sales in the history of that game. Even with the move of these events, hotel and motel occupancy increased last year by 3.4% over 2015. The average room rate of $98.88 per night represented a 3.6% jump from 2015. So the message is clear, despite what you may have heard. Sound public policy does not lead to bad economic results. If you have competitive tax and regulatory policy, businesses will come to your state. The businesses that you have in your state will grow. So hopefully, as we go forward, we will not listen to the voices that threaten economic Armageddon for protecting basic, fundamental human liberties. Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the will.
Chair recognizes the senator from the 41st, the minority leader.
Mr. President, members of the Senate, I rise today to raise my concerns over what we did this morning in reapportionment. We passed out changes to the House map, House Bill 515. You know, it has been presented to me in the past that we really need substantial or compelling reasons to change districts. People become part of a district. And in the committee, no substantial or compelling reasons were made for changing districts. I know that that bill will be moving the Rules Committee. So I'm speaking to the members of the Rules Committee and say, please search your heart. Remember that the substitute was given to the committee around 2 o'clock yesterday, it was testified, but yet the minority party didn't get a chance to see it. The members who came, the public people who came to the committee to talk didn't get a chance to see the changed maps. There were no public hearings besides the one we had today on this new map. That we didn't have, because of that, sufficient knowledge of who may have wanted to run for office in those districts that are being cut out. I've seen that done before. People actually just knock out a house or two because they know that John Smith or whoever may want to run against them. And we don't know for sure that's not the case. You know, recently, Before the election, there were claims of massive voter fraud. Since the election, we've seen concerns about foreign involvement in elections and whether election voting machines worked well and those sort of things. I think all of us feel confident that our elections will go on fair. And we have an obligation to the citizens of Georgia to make sure that happens. We have an obligation, too, to make sure that they trust and are confident in our elections process and that they are governed in a democracy that treats citizens fairly, and although we may be partisan, do not let those partisan concerns override the citizens and their right to vote. Therefore, I hope that the members of the Rules Committee, the leadership in this body, and in fact the members across the hall, after hearing the concerns today, will let that bill remain in the breast of the Rules Committee. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Members, all right, are we, so we got a number of folks that are wishing to speak on a point of personal privilege, I think. Senator, from the, were you wishing to recognize someone? Chair recognize Senator from the 56. Recognize someone? No?
Oh. Thank you, Mr. President. I just take an opportunity this morning to welcome my son, Will Albers, and his girlfriend, Gabby, who are here from the University of North Georgia, joining their dad today. Thank you.
All right. Glad to have you. Great honor. Chair recognizes Senator from the 9th.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I did want to rise to let everyone know my daughter is here paging today, so when you see her, please let her know. And treat her pretty well. But I also rise for a more sad reason, and that's our good friend John Richards, who visited us a few weeks ago. He has recently been placed in hospice care with his battle with cancer, and it's pretty bad. Last time I heard early this week is that he's already non-responsive. So I would actually like to ask the president for a moment of silence before we pray for him for either a miraculous recovery or a peaceful passing.
Senator has requested a moment of silence. A moment of silence. Please, if you would, let us pray. Amen.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator. Chair now recognizes Senator from the 26.
Thank you, Mr. President, and ladies and gentlemen of the Senate. I come today because of something disturbing. You know, over and over I've said that we need to deal with the fourth leg of state government, which is the Georgia Lottery. And it seems as though we have just placated not even to deal with it. But now there's a lawsuit about a top executive called a whistleblower because he would not give flawed sales projections. I don't think we need to go home and reading about it in the paper. I think the leadership of this Senate needs to dig in and find out. The gentleman from the 46th has passed a bill that said that so much would go to education and has dictated that. But also, I think we need to find out exactly what's going on. If there are no problems, then there are no problems. But it seems to me that we finna lose a lawsuit based on somebody being fired because they would not falsify figures. Over and over, I've said to you that we could give away a gift card, take the money out the video gaming machine and use a plastic card. And out of that, we get 4%. Projections are $2 billion they took in last year on the video gaming machines. 4% of that is $80 million. couple of million one way or the other. But $80 million will help us with a lot of these tax breaks we've given and put the money back in the coffers. But, Mr. President, I would ask you and the leadership to delve into the situation that has occurred and to try to make sure that we have the accurate information when it comes to the Georgia lottery.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 34th.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate. I rise to welcome a retiree who happens to be a friend of mine, and he is shadowing me today, Mr. Ken Hill. Stand up, Ken. Welcome, Ken. Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the well.
Thank you. Glad to have you with us. Senator from the 39th, you wishing to be recognized, you are recognized this time. Clear the center from the 26th light, his. And clear the center from the third, because I don't think his is on.
Mr. President, members of the Senate, I rise to follow up on the comments of Senator from the 41st about the redistricting process. Senator from the 41st is correct. The lack of transparency and openness in this process is glaring. When you take into consideration, among other things, that the minority party did not get the maps and the numbers until this very morning at 8 o'clock when the committee met, that is problematic. But beyond that, we were told that the House maps that came over to the Senate were illegal and constitutional. Some of us thought otherwise. As a matter of fact, the representative from the 53rd district in the city of Atlanta in Cobb County thought otherwise. African-American population from the 53rd was swapped in an obvious racial gerrymandering. But it was legal and constitutional a week ago. We were told it was routine maintenance. And now, when we show up this morning at 8 o'clock, that's all gone. I'm glad it's all gone. The 40th, the 53rd, and the 111 are gone from the map. We were told that the senators from the 40th and the senator, I mean the representative from the 40th and the 111th both asked for their districts to be taken out of the redistricting map. It is very curious, but if it was wrong, if it was bad, if it was legal and constitutional a week ago and it was routine maintenance, why didn't it stay in there? I think the reason may be that it was recognized that it was what? Political apartheid, racial gerrymandering at its worst. As a matter of fact, the 111th 2 years ago in 2015 passed the legislature and it diluted that district by 3% African American. Then 2 years later, another 3%, a total of 6% racial gerrymandering. So if in fact it was legal and constitutional and routine maintenance, what happened in this last week? That is a question that may be answered or it may not. But we're glad that the racial gerrymandering was taken out of this bill. We hope it doesn't reappear in 2018. I hope it doesn't reappear in 2020, and definitely not in 2021 when we redo these lines for the decennial census. Thank you, Mr. President. I appreciate this opportunity.
That concludes our points of personal privilege. Can I have a round of applause on that? Thank you very much. You have a consent calendar of privilege resolutions that are before you. Is there objection? Without objection, the consent calendar of privilege resolutions are therefore adopted. Are there any motions to withdraw or commit? We have a local consent calendar that is before you. Ms. Secretary, are there any objections that are filed on any of the local bills?
Mr. President, there are no objections filed.
Is there objection granted report of committee on the state and local governmental operation which failed pass the bill? All those in favor of the local consent calendar will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary, unlock the machine. On the passage of the local consent calendar, the yeas are 44, the nays are 1. And these bills have received requisite constitutional majorities, therefore adopted. Chair recognizes the distinguished majority leader.
Thank you, Mr. President. I ask unanimous consent that the following bills be engrossed. There are four bills, all coming from the Finance Committee. House Bill 340, House Bill 290, House Bill 134 and House Bill 117.
Is there objection? There is objection. There is objection. Is there objection to having a vote for all these at once? Combining the bills with one without objection, we'll combine House Bill 340, House Bill 290, House Bill 134, and House Bill 117, and you will be voting on engrossment of those bills collectively. All of those in favor of engrossment of the bills that are listed, rise, stand, and be counted. On the motion for engrossment, the yeas are 30 and the nays are 14, and all the bills have been engrossed. The finance bills have been engrossed. We are now ready to move on to the general calendar. Secretary will read House Bill 437.
House Bill 437 by Representative Dickey of the 140th and others, a bill be titled an act amend Article 2 of Chapter 14 and Title 20 of the CGA relating to education accountability assessment program so as to recreate the former Agriculture Education Advisory Commission, which had been abolished by operation of law on December 31st, 2016, and for other purposes. Mr. President, Senate Committee on Education and Youth recommends that this bill do pass. And I said her Tippett to 37th. That concludes the order.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 50th to present the number one industry of our great state, agriculture bill.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate. This bill would recreate the Agriculture Education Advisory Committee, which had a sunset of December the 31st, 2016. This is a commission with 12 appointees, appointed three by the governor, three by the state school superintendent, three from the House, and three from the Senate, that meets once a year to review the agriculture education programs in the state. I would urge your favorable consideration, Mr. President. If there are no questions, I'll yield the well.
There are no questions, Senator. Chair recognizes Senator from the 20th, gentleman from Houston County. No, he waves off. What is it? Cat got your tongue? You don't support ag. Okay, appreciate that, Senator. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection agreed on the report of committee which failed to pass the bill? Chair is none. The report of committee is agreed to. Should the main question be now put, or the objection? Chair is none. Main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Question on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 53, and the senator from the 53rd failed to vote for it. Very high, very ironic, Senator. 53 and the nays are 0. This bill, Hampshire Rex Constitution majority, is therefore adopted. Secretary Reed, House Bill 222.
House Bill 222 by Senators Representatives Blackman, 146, and others, a bill will be titled an act amend Part 7, Article 7, of Chapter 3 of Title 20 of the OCGA relating to Hope Scholarships and Grants so as to provide that members of the Georgia National Guard and Reservists meet residency requirements and for other purposes. Mr. President, Senate Committee on Higher Education recommends that this bill do pass by substitute. Senator Miller of the 40th. Mr. President, the Senate Higher Education Committee offers the following substitute to House Bill 222, a bill to be titled an act to change certain provisions relating to Hope Scholarships and Grants and the funding of such scholarships and grants, to amend Part 7 of Article 7 of Chapter 3 of Title 20 of the OCGA relating to Hope Scholarships and Grants so as to provide that members of the Georgia National Guard and Reservists meet residency requirements, to amend Code Section 502713 of the OCGA relating to disposition of lottery funds, budget report by Governor appropriations by General Assembly, and shortfall reserve subaccount so as to establish the percentage of the lottery proceeds for each fiscal year, which must equal the net proceeds to be transferred to the State Treasury for credit to the Lottery for Education account and for other purposes. That concludes the order.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 46th to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. Ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, pleasure to be with you as we start a long day working on House bills. House Bill 222 is a measure to make it easier for children of National Guards members to get the HOPE scholarship by waiving a residency requirement. It has not been changed in the Senate. You will notice we have a substitute. It adds Senate Bill 5, which we passed earlier, dealing with HOPE scholarship, lottery board profitability for HOPE scholarship. So it's a similar subject matter. There have been no changes to Senate Bill 5. It's the same version we passed out of here. But unfortunately, we've run into some resistance with that bill on the House side. It's been changed greatly in committee. And so I want to give them another chance to consider this wise legislation that we've passed. I would urge your favorable consideration of House Bill 222. Mr. President, if there are no questions, I'll yield the will.
All right. You have a question from Senator from the 26th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Senator, you.
I yield.
Senator, based on what you've tried to do and explaining what this Senate did was to try to increase the amount of money going into the scholarships for kids in the lottery. Am I correct?
You're correct, Senator. Both the HOPE scholarship program and the pre-K program, which uses about a third of the funds generated by the lottery.
Senator, would you yield again?
I'd be happy to yield to my friend from Macon.
I'm looking at an article, Judge Rules Whistleblower Suit Against Georgia Lottery Can Go Forward. Don't you think it's probably about time that this Senate indulges itself in just trying to find out whether it's a lie or the truth and what the actual figures are, since we're dealing with this money and all of a sudden here's something that's being questioned that we knew nothing of until it hit the paper?
Senator, I'm not completely familiar with the situation you're referencing, but yes, I do think that we have a responsibility to oversee the lottery board. It is set up independent from us, but we still have legislative authority, and I believe this is a good start. We can't do it all in one bill, but we'll be looking for other ways to help you.
No further questions, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the will.
Question is on the adoption of the committee substitute. Is there objection? Without objection, the committee substitute is adopted. Now, does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is there objection? Agreeing to report to committee which failed to pass the bill? Chair is none. Report to committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chair is none. Main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Question on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary, unlock the machine. On the pass of the bill, the yeas are 54 and the nays are 0. This bill having 0 ex constitution majority is therefore adopted. Secretary will read House Bill 88.
House Bill 88 by Representative Fleming, 121st and others. Bill will be titled an act amend Article 1 of Chapter 6 of Title 15 of the OCJA relating to general provisions regarding Superior Court judges so as to revise the qualifications for Superior Court judges and for other purposes. The President's Senate Committee on Rules recommends that this bill do pass by substitute. Submitted by Senator Moles to the 53rd. Mr. President, the Senate Committee on Rules offers the following substitute to House Bill 88, a bill with an act amend Title 15 of the OCJA relating to court so as to revise the qualifications for Superior and State Court judges to provide for the vacation such offices under certain circumstances, to provide for the selection of Chief Judge of the Superior Court for each judicial circuit and for other purposes. Mr. President, Amendment 1 by Mullis of the 53rd, Senator Mullis of the 53rd offers the following amendment. Amend the Senate Rules Committee substitute to House Bill 88 by inserting after matters on line 5 to provide for effective dates and by redesignating Section 4, Section 5 and inserting after line 72 the following. Section 4, Section 2 of this act shall become effective on July 1st, 2018. The remaining section shall become effective on July 1st, 2017. That concludes the order.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 23rd to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President and fellow senators. HB 88 does something that most people think should already have been the law. If a judge is disbarred or suspended by the state bar, by the Supreme Court of our state, then the office that he holds as either Superior Court judge or state court judge will be deemed vacated. The amendment deals with part two of the bill, and that simply authorizes circuits to select by majority vote the chief judge of the circuit. The amendment has a different effective date. It delays the implementation. I have no objection to that amendment, but the senator from the 53rd will have to speak to that. But otherwise, all parts of the bill and the amendment are recommended for your approval. Mr. President, if there are no questions, I'll yield the will.
Chair recognizes Senator on the 53rd for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Senator Yield.
Absolutely.
Thank you again for describing the amendment that I've already put on in committee. The floor amendment is just to change the date of Section 2, which is the determination when it all starts. That's all. We've delayed it a year, I think.
And I favor the amendment and the bill.
Thank you.
Thank you.
No further questions, Senator. You've already spoke. He spoke to the amendment, right? Is there objection to adoption of amendment number 1 authored by the Senator from the 53rd? Without objection, amendment number 1 will be adopted. Question now is on the adoption of the committee substitute as amended. Is there objection? Without objection, committee substitute as amended is now adopted. Now, does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection agreed to report to committee which favorable pass the bill? Chair is none. Report to committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? All those in favor of the bill vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary, unlock the machine. Thank you. on the passage of the bill. The yeas are 54, the nays are 0. And this bill, Hammer C-Rex Constitution majority, is therefore adopted. Senate from the 26th, what purpose you rise?
I guess parliamentary inquiry or point of order.
State your inquiry.
Mr. President, I would like to ask that the rules be suspended in order that a resolution be introduced and read for the first time.
I got it.
You got the resolution? Is it a friendly resolution or?
Try to make something legal, what everybody's doing illegal.
Is there objection? Is there objection to suspend the rules so we can read? Okay. We need to find a number. This one was dropped on us there at the last minute, but we'll get a number and we have a number. All right, is there objection? Without objection, the rule will be suspended so we can read the bill for the first time. Secretary will read.
Senate Resolution 527 by Senator Lucas of the 26th, a resolution proposing amend to the Constitution of the State of Georgia so as to authorize the General Assembly to provide by law for the operation and regulation of game show contests in the state to provide for related matters, to provide for the submission of this amendment or for ratification or rejection and for other purposes. That concludes the order.
We'll put the bill, we'll assign it to economic development. Secretary will read House Bill 340.
House Bill 340 by Representative Blackman and the 146th and others, bill will be titled an act amend Chapter 5C of Title 40 to the OCJ relating to alternative ad valorem tax on motor vehicles so as to change the manner of distribution of the proceeds of such tax and for other purposes. Mr. President, Senate Committee on Finance recommends that this bill be passed by substitute, submitted by Senator Huffstetler of the 52nd. Mr. President, Senate Committee on Finance offers the following substitute to House Bill 340, a bill be titled an act amend Chapter 5C of Title 40 of the OCJ relating to alternative ad valorem tax on motor vehicles so as to change the manner for determining the fair market value of motor vehicles subject to the tax, to provide for the fair market value determination of kit cars, to provide for the fees of the tag agent, to provide for the promulgation of a standardized form, to provide for the submission of title applications and title ad valorem tax fees by dealers, to provide for penalties for failure to timely submit title applications and title ad valorem fees, to provide for the tax amounts on vehicles which were registered in other states, to provide for refunds, to provide for the transfers as a result of a divorce decree or court order, and for other purposes. Mr. President, there is a there is a fiscal note attached to House Bill 340. That concludes the order.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 52nd to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm happy to be presenting House Bill 340 that has undergone a considerable amount of work. I also want to thank those senators that were here in 2012, the year before I got here, that gave us this as we continue to try to perfect this previous bill. What this bill will do will change several things. One is it's had a detrimental effect on leasing. The tax was applied to the entire value of the car for leasing, So if a car was worth $50,000, you would pay 7% on $50,000. Now, if the lease payments for, say, a two-year lease total $20,000, you would pay 7% on that $20,000. We also have had a pretty tough Welcome to Georgia bill that people get when they move into the state. This bill would limit that to $1,100 cap for those that come into the state. Additionally, one of the changes was that on used cars that were all taxed the same as new cars at 7% prior to March of 2013, now they will go back to the sales price of what they're sold for, not the book value. So new cars and used cars will be treated exactly the same, except with one exception, and that's the self-financed that will still be allowed to be at book value. Those are the major changes in this bill. I believe I've got the new car dealers in support of it, and the Independent Automobile Dealers Association has also asked for your support on this bill. If there's no questions, I'll yield the well.
Chair recognized, Senator from the 39th. Let's quieten the chamber down just a little bit. We're a little bit too chattery in here.
Will Senator yield?
I'll yield to my suite mate.
Isn't it true, Senator, that this bill would raise taxes on people who buy used cars except for a small carve out?
Well, we have carved out an amendment for those self-financed cars that people consider that to be the poor people, to leave them as it is. However, prior to 2013, everything that was sold was based on the sales price of the car. And this was the only thing in the state of Georgia that was not based on what you actually buy for. So the concept is you're going to actually pay tax on what you pay for, like every other thing in the state of Georgia.
Will the senator further yield?
I'll yield.
Isn't it true that presently, though, I'm not talking about prior to 2013, today, that a buyer of a used car, is, if this bill passes, except for a small carve-out, the buy here, pay here folk, which are 300 out of 5,700, right now in 2017, except for that, I mean, at this point, this bill would increase the taxes that a used car buyer pays. Is that true?
If the system was that they were using a value that was lower than what the sales price was, then yes, now that would be an increase.
Okay.
Now, where we're saving is that the leasing business was devastated by this bill by charging them the full price of a vehicle that they weren't getting the full price of, and the out-of-state people were getting an unwelcome welcome to Georgia with a heavy fee, and this addresses that. I think it makes it much fairer than what was passed the year before I came here.
Will the senator yield for one further
question? I'll yield, certainly.
Having said that, though, the people who are buying that used car are a different segment of people than who are doing leases. And while it evens out in the bottom line, those people who are buying used cars are going to be paying more. Isn't that true, except for that small carve out?
The senator knows of which he speaks. I haven't bought a new car since 2008. I like buying used cars with a year or two off. I save thousands of dollars, and so I imagine I'll be paying sales tax on what I actually paid for the car.
Thank you.
Chair recognized, Senator from the 10th, for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Would Senator yield?
I'll yield.
Senator, isn't it true that a lot of consumers would save money on the purchase of their new car with this particular legislation?
They won't save money on the purchase of their new car. They'll be paying exactly what they were paying, the sales tax price.
Senator, is it not true that those new car customers that lease cars are paying less money since they don't have to pay all of the sales taxes up front?
I think the bill that passed, again, as I say, the year before I got here, devastated the lease car business. They're not getting a $50,000 value for that car. they've got the use of that card for 2 years. So if that lease payment is $20,000, they will now be paying what I consider fair. They'll be paying 7% on what they actually get out of that car in that 2 year period. And additionally, that car is going to turn over to somebody else, and the state will also get money at that point.
Senator Yale?
I'll yield.
Senator, isn't it on a lot of, for a lot of consumers, that they get a better value by leasing cars regardless of their socioeconomic condition?
That get a better value by leasing cars?
Yes.
I think in certain circumstances, people are better off leasing cars and others are not. And of course, that depends on their mileage and everything else. But again, they're paying sales tax on what the value they got out of that car, not the full price of that car, which they don't own.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Senator on the 23rd for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the Senator yield?
I'll yield to the first office mate I had when I came down here.
This is just for my information purposes. Is the $20,000, does that apply to all leased vehicles regardless of the value?
$20,000 was just an arbitrary figure. If you pay $500 a month for a lease car for 2 years, then 500 times 12 times 2 years is the value you're getting out of that car, and you'll pay 7% on that value.
Was that something of an average of what lease cars may be worth during the time that you?
Well, it was a different system back then, but the original bill had some unintended consequences, and that was that you pay so much for a vehicle that you're not getting to keep that it greatly discourage leasing in the state.
And the cap on the Welcome to Georgia tax, how was that obtained?
Well, that was through negotiation among the committee, and of course the House may look at that and have a different opinion, but many people talked about having to pay thousands of dollars when they came in, and we felt that that was a reasonable cap that would still allow the bill to be fiscally neutral.
All right. Thank you very much.
Chair recognized Senator from the 26th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Gentleman,
We need to quieten down the chamber. Chamber needs to quieten down. We have a number of folks here, but we want to make certain that the senator and the well can hear. So please keep your voices in a very quiet voice. Senate from 26.
Senator, yield.
I'll yield.
Senator, isn't this trying to solve a problem where the state was getting a windfall and there were several communities outside of the metro area who what they call the TVAT tax, and they kept talking about truing up, and they never could true up. They were always collecting taxes to pay for the previous years and never got anything out of it. Yet they, when they look on their books, their car registrations were going up, but not commensurate to the money that they were bringing in.
There are some people that would say that perhaps some of the bigger counties were coming out better than some of the smaller counties with this, and this is trying to address that.
And this is trying to address it. Would the Senator further yield?
I'll yield.
What happens now? Where does the pickup of that money come from? What happens to the used car dealer that where you might pay them rather than have it financed, it's financed through them and you pay them for your car?
If you pay them, those dealers will be paying 7%, the exact same as a new car. Everybody pays 7%, just like everything else is in the entire state of Georgia. You pay it based on what you actually paid for that purchase.
So what I'm understanding you to say, I would, if I went and bought a used car from a used car dealer I financed, I would pay 7% tax.
There are some, they call them buy here, pay here, that do self-financing. Exempted out.
And when you say exempted out, what do you mean?
They continue to do the book value. They got a lower rate in that previous bill that was here, and there is an exception carved out for those because some people felt like those were the poorest people and they wanted to try to leave something in place for them. So they are exempted out under this.
With the Senate for the year.
I yield.
So what you're saying is they would use the book value, the blue, what we call the blue book.
Correct.
And if the car was too old, it would just be based on whatever the value would be.
That's correct. The value of the car, not necessarily the sale price.
All right.
However, with one exception, now with individuals selling to each other, it also stays at book value because there's a feeling somebody might say, I'm going to sell it to you for a dollar and avoid the tax, and you give me some money on the side. So with those, it stays at book value on casual sales.
One further question. That doesn't stop me for a dollar giving a car to my son, does it?
If you have a car that you're selling to another individual, you would pay the book price on it.
All right, but did that one final question. I understand part of it.
Yeah.
If I got a buddy over here of mine that's falling on hard time.
Okay, let me tell you, there's an exemption in a couple of categories. One for relatives and for a divorce. A car that people have been paying, thousands of people have been paying extra just to transfer a car in a divorce, this is exempted out under this bill.
All right.
I think you took care of him on that one. Chair recognizes Senator from the 40th for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will you yield for a couple of questions?
Thank you. I sure will yield.
I'm going to try to simplify it. Let's take the consumer. I buy a car from another individual. The tax I'm going to pay is based on the average of the fair market value and the wholesale value, right?
Correct.
Okay. I buy the same car from a dealer. I'm going to pay the tax on the price I paid for that car.
Correct.
Okay. If my son bought a car from me, he doesn't pay the tax.
Correct.
The last thing is, as a lessee of a car, the consumer, what am I paying the tax on? Is it the value of the car that I have for the period I have? How does that work?
You're not paying on the value of the car. You may get a new car that's worth $50,000.
Right.
What you're going to pay on is the total lease payments.
So I take the total lease payments, let's say I lease it for 3 years, and the lease payments are $30,000. I'm going to pay the tax on the $30,000.
On $30,000, not $50,000.
That's what I thought. Thank you very much.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 3rd for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Does the Senator yield?
I'll yield.
I just want to go back to a question that was asked a few moments ago that left the impression that if you buy a used car, you automatically are going to be paying more tax. Under the old system, the tax was based on some figures that were published in a guide, correct?
Correct.
So if your purchase price was actually less than that amount, you were paying more taxes than you should based on what you paid for because your tax was calculated by what was published in a guide, correct?
The senator knows of which he speaks. You're going to base it on
the purchase
what you paid
now
for the car. You might pay more or less.
Or you may pay less.
But it's whatever
so
you paid
it on.
It's
based on the purchase price, which is a more accurate reflection of the fair market value of a car, what a willing buyer and a willing seller would pay, correct?
Right.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Senator in the 46th for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the gentleman yield?
I'll yield.
I got lost on the colloquy there about the shifting of tax revenue from the state to the counties. Does either the fiscal note or your research indicate how much money we're talking about here that ordinarily, if we don't amend the law, would be received by the state of Georgia, will now be being transferred to the local counties?
We're trying, and the fiscal note that we have is based on the House bill, and there have been some changes here. But what we're trying to do is even out to the counties based more on their digest versus just an, you know, per capita basis. This bill is not a revenue plus for the state of Georgia. If you look at the five-year history.
I get that. I'm trying to figure out how much of a revenue minus it is. What kind of hole are we making in our budget by shifting the tax revenues to the counties?
Well, that part has been lessened in the Senate bill, so the fiscal note is not accurate. But I do believe the state will continue to receive what it's been receiving. though there is a possibility in later years under the House bill that $1 billion would go down to about $900 million to the state.
Thanks, Senator.
Chair, recognize Senator 26.
One question, that gentleman, yeah.
I yield.
Isn't it true, with everything that's happened, Metro County, because you had plenty of sales, that was never a problem. It was in your outlying areas. And isn't it true, under this, and what they decided to do was to make sure that the counties were whole and got the money before the state took it out, and then rearrange the monies and the financing of how they got the money and stuff. The state still wins, but your local governments in a lot of your rural areas don't have to worry about trying to true up and catch up. Now, isn't that correct?
I think in the rural areas they will be treated more fairly under this bill.
No further questions, Senator.
I thought maybe there were one or two that hadn't asked a question yet, but I ask for your favorable consideration of this bill. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator from the 39th, you wish to speak to the bill? You're recognized to do so.
I'm going to be very short. The questions in the debate were very thorough. All I do want to say is revenue neutral. When is revenue neutral not revenue neutral? When you get hit. You know, the combination of this tax increase on used car buyers and tax decrease on people who lease makes it generally revenue neutral, except if you're the one paying the tax increase. This is a tax increase. There's been a carve out of the 5,700 used car dealers. There's been a carve out for the pay here, buy here folk. That's 300 used car dealerships. That's 300 out of almost 6,000, less than 10%, about 5%. This is a tax increase. Just because you're giving a break to the people who lease doesn't make it a good thing. It's a different demographic that lease than the demographic that buys used cars. And so we are, if we're gonna vote for it, if we support it, we ought to just acknowledge that it is a tax increase. And, you know, and I heard the question and answer regarding people who say, well, some people were paying lower taxes. Bottom line is, there are going to be more people who take a tax hit than take a tax decrease. You know, that's just the reality of it. We ought to just say what we're going to do, vote for it, and be proud of it, or vote against it, and stand up for folk who buy used cars and who need and don't need increase in their taxes. So I'm going to vote against it. I hope you vote against it and stand up for working people who are buying used cars in the state of Georgia. I yield well, unless there are questions that I'd be glad to take.
No questions, Senator.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 10th, speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President, and members of this body. It's not too often that I disagree with my colleague from the 39th, but on this particular case, I have to strenuously disagree. Having been in the automobile business for very close to 30 years, I think there are some peculiarities of our business that he does not quite understand. First of all, I want to clear something up. The number of cars that are leased in this state has decreased dramatically. In my particular stores, I think I lease less than 2% of the cars that I sell. And the reason why they've decreased is because we changed how the taxes collected, was driven up the price on leasing a car.
This bill simply fixes a mistake that we put in the bill that's caused this industry that we had that was very bright, vibrant in the state to decrease tremendously. And I think the numbers I've seen is reflective of the numbers that other dealers across the state has seen as well. Let me clear up something else. Used car leases are driven by the manufacturer. We do not set what the value is on the cars that we lease. And if you want to compute how a lease payment on a car, you have to take the sale price, and then you have to take what the value of that car is at the end of that lease term. And then that's how you arrive at what the residual value is. The dealers have no control over what that residual value may be. Now, to spur the sale of new cars, the manufacturers routinely come in with rebates and other incentives on every car line. I don't think I represent the high-end new car dealers. I have some domestic brands that sell affordable cars, like Ford sells affordable cars. And our cars on the very end, the bottom of the price scale, we lease just as many of those as we do on the very high end of the cars that this particular manufacturer sell. So I would encourage you to take to vote favorably for this bill. It is revenue neutral. There are a lot of consumers in this state that will benefit from this bill. Our industry as a whole will benefit from this bill, which means my employees will benefit tremendously from having work to do, and cars that are being sold really generates a lot for this overall economy for this state. So I would encourage you to strongly support House Bill 340, which has been a great compromise between the new car dealers, and I shouldn't say used car dealers, because most of the used cars in this state are sold by new car dealers as well. But I would strongly recommend your favorable consideration for House Bill 340. And Mr. President, if there's no questions, I will yield away.
One question. Chair recognized 36. Senator from 36, you have a question.
Thank you. The Senator, you...
I do.
Senator, you haven't addressed this in your remarks thus far, but isn't it true that we need to remind ourselves that when the law was changed with the 2012 bill, there was a lot of fallout. The state recognized a $500 million revenue uptick from that 2012 bill. And sadly, some of it was at the expense of county government, local government, who benefits from sales tax and shares the sales tax ordinarily, but that this change really shortchanged, that the 2012 bill really shortchanged our local government. Isn't that the case?
That is absolutely correct,
Senator. So you're familiar with that aspect of the bill, and that the ACCG and the GMA have been working, and local officials have been seeking to get some more parity and address some long overdue issues around how this revenue is split between the state and the local government, and that this bill seeks to improve that.
That's correct, and the Senator from the 36 certainly knows of which she speaks.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
No further questions,
Senator.
Questions on
Senate Bill HB 340. Thank you.
Question on the adoption of the committee substitute. Is there objection? Without objection, committee substitute is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is there objection? Agree on a port of committee, which favorable pass the bill. Chair is none. Port of committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are the objections? Chair is none. Main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Question on the pass the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. Thank you. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 49, the nays are 5, and this bill, MC Rex Constitutional Majority, is therefore adopted. We are going to take our lunch break now. Lunch is in the ante room that is served, and chair will recognize Senator on the 53rd for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. President. Just want to remind Rules Committee members, we'll be having a quick, short meeting at this time in room 450. So if you can, please join me there. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator from the 36th is recognized.
Colleagues, we have competing lunches. If you'd like to join us for lunch, the Working Families is hosting a wrap-up lunch in room 307 CLOB. Looking at the hot button issues that remain before us for these last 3 days of the 2017 session. Metro Atlanta Chamber and the CWA are sponsoring that lunch, and you're welcome to join us there for some chit chat and good food as well.
Chair, we will reconvene at 1:15.